Professor B. Shanti from Kilpok Medical College, Professor P. Tangamani from Madras Medical College, Professor R. Manivannan from Stanley Medical College, and Dr. Professor Pandyarajan. Welcome, sir and ma'am, onto the stage. And I would like to call upon Shilpa, Ajay, and Karthik Saravanan.
So now we are going to the most important topic, that is intestinal obstruction. When you see acute abdomen presenting in our OPDs, nearly 8 to 15% of the people have presented with intestinal obstructions. So when we consider intestinal obstruction, I would like to present two case scenarios which are different that presented in our hospital. Both the cases were taken from Professor Tangamani's unit, and Sari is also here. So it will be an interactive session. The first group of students will be going through the first case scenario.
Sir, I think they missed one faculty. Can I request Professor Ratnasamy sir to go up to the stage, please?
Please,
both
sir.
Both of you, please.
Please, sir. So let the first set of students read the first case scenario.
Both of you participate.
Case scenario one, case history. A 62-year-old male came with chief complaints of diffuse abdominal pain for 15 days with abdominal distension and vomiting for 1 week. History of presenting illness. History of sudden onset of diffuse abdominal pain for 15 days, which was intermittent, colicky, dull aching type, non-radiating, aggravated by intake of food, relieved by medications. History of multiple episodes of bilious non-projectile vomiting for the past 1 week. History of abdominal distension for 7 days. History of obstipation for 2 days.
So the first question is, what are the classical quartet of symptoms that can occur in intestinal obstruction?
Abdominal pain, vomiting, abdominal distension, and obstipation.
The history clearly suggests that is a case of an intestinal obstruction.
History of decreased urine output and passing high-colored urine for the past 2 days. Past history. Patient is a known hypertensive since 3 years and on regular medication. No history of previous surgeries.
Why history of previous surgery is very important when you are examining a case of intestinal obstruction?
For additions.
I would like to ask panelists, what is the importance of either post-operative or the history of previous surgeries when you consider intestinal obstruction?
Good evening, Kanan. The history of previous surgery is very important whenever you are dealing with the intestinal obstruction in a post-operative case, because mostly it will be an adhesive obstruction. It will be adhesive colic first, then goes for adhesive obstruction. If it is not attended, it might go for the later stage of peritonitis, all the things. So post-operative is adhesive obstruction comes in first in mind.
In the era of laparoscopic surgery, do you still feel there are cases of obstruction present?
Even in laparoscopic surgery, you can get adhesive obstruction.
So, students, you should know that history of laparoscopic surgery also you must note. It does not only laparotomy, but even a minimal laparoscopic procedure, even a diagnostic lab can cause intestinal obstruction.
No history of drug allergies, personal history. Patient takes normal diet, has normal bowel and bladder habits, is a chronic smoker. Examination, patient is well built and nourished.
Before you go into the examination, I'm here. With the history, sir. Where do you think is the obstruction? Can you put the first slide? First slide. Before. With this history, where do you think is the obstruction in this patient?
Small bowel obstruction, abdominal.
The reason for saying so?
Obstruction. History of pain and then distension occurring much later in large bowel obstruction, the distension is much more prominent.
Is the type of pain gives any clue to your site of obstruction?
Aggravated by intake of food.
Is it colicky pain?
Colicky.
Does it Sir? Convey anything to you?
Small bowel obstruction.
The patient has got projectile vomiting. What does it convey to you?
Non-projectile vomiting.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Sorry.
Yes, sir.
Colicky pain suggests that it may be in the
small bowel. Patient is conscious, alert, oriented and afebrile. There is no signs of pallor, icterus, cyanosis, clubbing or pedal edema. Vitals are stable. The other systems are normal. On per abdomen examination, the abdomen appears distended, all quadrants moving equally with respiration. Umbilicus is central. No previous surgical scars are noted. No visible peristalsis or pulsations are seen. Hernial orifices appear normal. External genitalia appear normal.
What is the importance of hernial? They say, no, hernial orifices are free. Is it essential to examine in every case of intestinal obstruction?
Yes, maybe the patient would have presented with the obstruction, it would have gone by itself. It should not be missed in the examination. That's why you ask the hernial orifice to be seen regularly in all cases of intestinal obstruction.
Suppose in a female patient?
Yes, it can.
We have to examine.
Can I just add one point? It's an inguinal hernia is quite often mentioned by the patient. What can easily be missed is a femoral hernia with obstruction. And always need to examine the patient, having them undressed sufficiently to expose the femoral orifice. Because you shouldn't have a situation where you open the abdomen, find there's obstruction, and find there's a small loop stuck in a hernia. It'll be rather an unpleasant experience.
The palpation, there's diffuse abdominal tenderness. There is no warmth. There is guarding present, no rigidity, and no mass palpable per abdomen. There's no organomegaly on percussion.
Can we differentiate a simple obstruction from a strangulation by palpation?
Yes. Yes.
Strangulation where? In the hernia?
In any. Even
see,
in
that's right. Once any obstruction goes for a compromise. You go for peritonitis, there'll be guarding everywhere. So that's a sign of the strangulation, whatever it is.
Say they say rebound tenderness, but you should not wait for that. Rebound tenderness in an intestinal obstruction says it is strangulating or strangulated. Whereas in an inflammation like appendicitis, rebound tenderness says it is strangulated or it is strangulating.
So Kannan, recently I had one case. 80-year-old lady presented with intestinal obstruction. All the investigation done was normal, including CT everything. So I went to open it up. It was a obturator hernia obstructed.
Yes, sir.
And strangulated also.
On percussion, there is no obliteration of liver dullness.
Why we should know about the obliteration of liver dullness here?
To look for
perforation.
Air under that. On auscultation, bowel sounds are exaggerated.
So in 90% of cases of intestinal obstruction with exaggerated bowel sounds, when the patient is having intestinal colic with exaggerated bowel sounds, it is 90% a case of intestinal obstruction.
Per rectal examination, the tone is normal. There is no fecal stain.
Why should we do a per rectal examination in a case of intestinal obstruction?
To look for any fecal staining, ballooning of the rectum.
Expert, sir?
Look for any nodule growth.
It can be a growth underneath also. This may be a large bubble as well as a... No, you cannot differentiate here between a small bubble and a large bubble. It can be.
So what is your probable diagnosis in this case?
It's a case of a small bubble obstruction.
Intestinal obstruction. Acute intestinal obstruction. So what do you how do you differentiate acute intestinal obstruction and acute and chronic intestinal obstruction? What does it say?
Previous history of constipation.
So let us ask our experts. Acute intestinal obstruction, acute and chronic.
What sir is trying to ask you is, when you call chronic obstruction, a patient gets obstruction, gets relieved. Like in your adhesive obstructions, you do this one. Like that, sometimes you can get a gallstone ileus also. The stone going and stopping at the ileocecal junction, they can get relieved like that. So that suddenly present at acute symptom can be acute on chronic intestinal obstruction.
Investigations. Complete blood count was normal. Urea and creatinine were mildly elevated, which later normalized after adequate hydration. Liver function test was normal. Serum electrolytes were normal. X-ray erect abdomen.
Do we need an X-ray erect view in all cases of acute intestinal obstruction who cannot be mobilized? Expert, sir.
I think one of the main things to highlight here is that a supine film gives you much more information than an erect film. The supine film will tell you the degree of dilatation of the intestine, whether the distension is only the small intestine or large intestine also, and usually you can come to a reasonable conclusion on the level of the obstruction. Second, on an occasion with large bowel obstruction, the cecal diameter is very critical. And a distension of the cecum with a competent ileocecal valve is a so-called closed-loop obstruction. So a supine film also tells you about the thickness of the small bowel wall, the edema, which signifies that there is a certain amount of peritonitis. So it's a supine film that gives you more information. The erect film is probably just to see the fluid levels and doesn't give you much more information, or to look for free gas under the diaphragm. That's the only real help of doing an erect film.
Can we differentiate the level of obstruction from the X-ray? Experts? Whether it is in the jejunum, ileum, or colonic obstruction?
If the large bowel is distended, then definitely the obstruction, if you see gas distension in the large bowel, it's definitely the obstruction is in the colon. But if there's no dilatation of the large intestine, then most likely the obstruction is in the small intestine.
So for the postgraduates, if it is a jejunal obstruction, what are the features?
Valvic continence is seen. Continence is seen. Ileum is featureless. And in large bowel obstruction, there is haustrations which are seen.
So you should know these, whether it's central or peripheral. And you should know all these features, and so that you can make a clear-cut diagnosis of an intestinal obstruction, as well as you can make a decision whether to operate or not also. What is the role of oral gastrography in study in intestinal obstruction? Is it essential?
Sir, generally we don't do. If at all, you have a doubtful diagnosis, like the obstruction comes and goes, you want to establish a diagnosis, you can do a small bowel enema or gastrocolysis, where you pass the Ryle's tube above the duodenal junction and send a oral consult, either gastrography or anything, and take a thing, and you can know the site of obstruction. Generally, we don't do this.
So can we do an ultrasonogram for the students, ultrasonogram and CT in intestinal obstruction? And what will be the features?
Ultrasonogram can be done to look for any free fluid, dilated bowel lobes, to look for any growth that can
be. So is there any correlation between the size of the bowel loop and the obstruction?
Look for the thickness of the bowel, dilatation, size of dilatation.
That's what I'm asking. In case of a small bowel, how much it should be dilated?
More than 3 centimeters.
In case of a cecum?
Cecum must be more than 13.5 centimeters.
That is, it will perforate. If it's 14, it will perforate.
More than 3 centimeters is indication for surgery.
78 centimeters? You should think, no, it's pathological. Then if it is a transverse colon, sigmoid colon like that?
More than 6 centimeters is an indication.
5 centimeters, no, we can. So ultrasonogram can help, CT will help. Can you differentiate by CT whether there is a strangulation?
Yes.
What are the features?
Mesenteric fluid levels.
Yes, the absence of mesenteric fluid and?
Bowel wall thickening.
Enhancement.
Enhancement.
That can give an idea whether it is going to be strangulated.
You can get that nematosis, sir, on the wall of the bowel wall.
Radiological investigation.
CT finding.
CCT abdomen showed evidence of narrowing of ileal loops at about 8 to 10 centimeters from ileocecal junction, resulting in dilated bowel loops proximal to it. Large bowel appears normal, no evidence of bowel wall thickening, impression partial small bowel obstruction with transition point 8 to 10 centimeters from ileocecal valve.
What are the differential diagnoses for a partial obstruction?
Gallstone ileus.
Tubercle strictures.
So how do you classify small bowel obstruction? Intramural?
Intramural, luminal and extramural.
So tell me a few examples.
Intraluminal, gallstone ileus, bezoars, foreign bodies, impacted stools. Intramural is malignancies, strictures, intussusception and volvulus. Extramural is bands and adhesions, internal hernias and external hernias.
For postgraduates, which is the narrowest part of small bowel?
Ileocecal.
Narrowest part of a small bowel?
Ileocecal junction.
It is not ileocecal junction.
10-2.
Anybody?
It's where the gallstone gets impacted, terminal ileum 15 to 20 centimeters proximal to the ileocecal junction.
You should give an why it is like that. Why it is, that is a narrow spot. You can't say 10 centimeter, 15 centimeter like that. Where will you get Meckel's?
2 feet from the ileocecal.
It need not be 2 feet from the proximal, 2 feet from the ileocecal junction. Anywhere from 5 centimeters to 75 centimeters it can occur. That is a study says. But usually we take it as the 2 feet from the ileocecal junction. Sir, am I not correct, sir? Gastroenterologist, sir.
My knowledge, I don't know. I think it's supposedly the embryological fusion point of the vitellovator.
Yes, sir. So they say a sun should not rise and set in a case of a intestinal obstruction. So when to decide to operate?
Before that, shall I ask you, what are the clinical criteria or observations based on which you would decide, either clinical or some laboratory values, upon which you will decide to operate?
Patient is in sepsis or in shock?
No, not that first. Bedside criteria, your clinical criteria and basic lab investigations upon which you would decide whether to open or not. You are holding the patient's hand.
Tachycardia, presence of tachycardia.
Progressive tachycardia will be one answer, yes.
Progressive tachycardia.
Dehydration.
Progressive abdominal distension, progressive. Okay, tachycardia. Next thing.
Guarding. Evidence of guarding and rigidity per abdomen examination.
Guarding leading on to rigidity, maybe. Okay. Any other lab investigations?
Lab investigations.
Leukocytosis.
Leukocytosis.
All the clinical criteria. Next, what's circled, you can tell. What's the time period which is crucial to make a decision upon opening?
initial 6 hours, sir?
6 hours. What do you mean by 6 hours?
Either two sunsets or two sunrises. Sorry.
Actually.
That makes it 36 hours.
See, you have to see the vomitus, this one also, rise to aspiration. When the color was bilious, all of a sudden it's changing to a feculent. That means you have waited enough. Okay.
Yeah, just to add one more point. One of the important decisions you have to make in a patient with intestinal obstruction is whether it is a strangulated obstruction or simple obstruction. In a simple obstruction, you can wait. In a strangulation obstruction, every minute adds to the morbidity of the patient. And this is not an easy decision to make, but by and large, this can be made on the bedside. As already mentioned, the tachycardia, the leukocytosis, guarding, rebound tenderness, all are in favor of a strangulated obstruction. If in a patient with simple obstruction, you manage them conservatively for a period of 12 hours, you find that the pain settles, you give fluids, the tachycardia settles, patient is more comfortable. And that should encourage you to give some more time of conservative management before you intervene surgically. Whereas if you find within 12 hours there is no improvement in the status of the patient, continues to have tenderness, tachycardia, rebound tenderness, I think you shouldn't be waiting any longer. All other investigations that you use are only going to be an additional information that you're going to have. And the decision to operate is by and large based on a clinical.
So in this case, as they thought it's a partial obstruction, they decided to go for a diagnostic lab.
This particular patient, he has got guarding and tenderness, severe tenderness.
Yes, yes.
And as you rightly said, the CT has not given. It says it is partial obstruction, but it doesn't say whether the patient has got gangrene. Because non-enhancement of the bowel in the contrast phase indicates that the bowel may be gangrenous, in which case there is no point in doing a laparoscopy. You have to straight away go for a laparotomy.
Yes.
Laparoscopy, that's a treatment as such, not diagnosis.
So what was the intraoperative findings in this case?
Small bowel was mildly distended, minimal free fluid, and inflamed appendices epiploike from mid-transverse colon extending up to a point of 10 centimeters from the DJ flexure attached to the necrotic mesenteric node, which is obstructing the distal ileum. Distal portion of inflamed appendices epiploike divided with the lap harmonic scalpel and clips applied over the stump. Cut end of the inflamed appendices epiploike receded and could not be traced laparoscopically. Hence, mini laparotomy made and throat laparotomy was done. Inflamed appendices epiploike over the transverse colon is identified, ligated and excised in toto, sent for HPE. The distal end of the band is identified and found to be attached to the necrotic lymph node of size 3 into 2 centimeters. Base is transfixed with vicryl sutures and samples taken for HPE. Hemostasis secured.
So I request Professor Thangamani sir to describe.
See, actually, this is a case of he came with the intestinal obstruction, actually an intermittent obstruction. I wanted to actually pose a question to you. In your clinical findings, there was a mention that VGP peristalsis was absent. I wanted to ask you the implication of this in an intestinal obstruction. So you observe the patient in ward for quite some time. You don't find visible gastric peristalsis or intestinal peristalsis, and still the patient shows signs of obstruction, you deem to take it as a case of intermittent obstruction. That was the case with this patient. The patient was all right for one day, again having pain with abdominal distension. And so we thought our pre-op, pre-lap diagnosis was a band addition only. Of course, we couldn't make out what the band was due to, and we posted him for a exploratory laparotomy, and we found that the band actually extended from an inflamed appendix epiploike to a node. So the node, ultimately the HP also came out as non-specific only.
They say 80% of intestinal obstruction affecting the small bowel is benign due to either band. whereas 80% of the cases where large bowel obstruction is there, it is usually a malignant etiology.
Biopsy reports, sample A, inflamed appendices epiploike, shows mature adipocytes with extensive area of necrosis and hemorrhage, focal aggregates, neutrophils and necrotic debris.
So what are the most common causes of intestinal obstruction when it affects the small bowel? As per the percentage of occurrence?
Adhesive obstruction, bands,
hernias. So these are the two causes. This is a rare occasion of an inflamed appendix epiploike that has caused obstruction. So let us go to the next case scenario.
Case 2, 75 years female, Mrs. X, complains of abdomen pain for 3 days and vomiting for 2 days. And history of present illness, okay. The abdomen pain is for 3 days, acute in onset. Abdomen distended, phalanx free, and dilated veins seen laterally, umbilicus in midline. The abdomen erect X-ray shows dilated bowel loops, possibly due to valveless.
Sir, any idea? He says it could be due to valveless, but he has made a large bowel obstruction. And to that level, we are now clear. The first case scenario was small bowel obstruction. The next case scenario, what we are going to do is a large bowel obstruction. And I already told you 80% of the large bowel obstruction, malignancy is the cause. Plain CT,
abdomen shows dilated large bowel loops, diameter of about 6.5 centimeter, possible transition point at rectosigmoid region. Intraoperative findings, adhesive band between transverse colon and pelvic wall and parietal wall, rectosigmoid growth about 5 cm felt in the rectosigmoid junction, gross distension of large bowel from cecum to sigmoid colon, cecum pre-gangrenous, appendix grossly dilated, transverse serous LTS seen over the proximal transverse colon. The adhesive band between sigmoid and pelvic wall is probably due to tumor infiltration. Omental biopsy taken and no free fluid, liver is normal.
The case scenario is rectosigmoidal growth. Here it is infiltrating to the pelvic wall. And there is a gross distension of the bowel and cecum dilated and gangrenous. There are tears in the transverse colon. So it is a clear-cut case of a closed loop obstruction with gangrene. So you can see the serous tear in the
cecum.
Tinea. So why they have not, attempted the resection of the rectosigmoidal junction?
So a specimen is rectosigmoid growth or
yes,
including a small intestine also?
I'll tell you. So it's a very unusual case. Usually when you have a rectosigmoidal growth, you'll have the closed loop obstruction. When the ileocecal junction is incompetent, even the small bowel get dilated. But here, it has caused a distension of the cecum, and the cecum cannot hold more than 14 centimeters of distension. When it is reaching the 14 centimeter, it is going to rupture or perforate. And there are impending rupture of the tinea coli in the transverse colon. As the DAS felt that he could not do the a proper procedure, that is a resection of the primary, because it is already adherent to the pelvic wall. In order to save the patient, he did a right hemicolectomy, mucous fistula, and an ileostomy.
This is why when you do a laparotomy, you get a lot of these findings. You have to match work according to the situation.
That's what, sir.
It's not just you cannot do resect everything. For saving the patient, this procedure has been done. It's not a procedure to be done for. Otherwise, if there is no perforation or any tear, would have gone for an ostomy and then planned further. Because unprepared bowel.
Has he left the growth as a heart mass?
He has left the growth because he cannot dissect it. He's already infiltrated. So he has to go for neoadjuvant chemotherapy. Uh-huh. There's no other way, sir. We have to respect the DA's situation on that day, that he has to save the patient from the already perforated bowel and impending perforation of the transverse colon. There's no other go to do, only a ileostomy and the mucous, I mean, that is the transverse colostomy. So these are all the tricky situations you can get. Never expect easy things to occur in case of an intestinal obstruction.
For the PGs, why an anastomosis? There was a tear in the transverse colon. Why anastomosis was not performed? They did a big procedure.
Yes, sir.
Since it can do a simple, but why it was not done in this case?
Since the bowel is grossly dilated, sir, there will be bowel
wall
disparity.
So you have to make in the mind that this grossly dilated bowel, you have not to do an anastomosis.
Thank you very much, sir. So I have taken the two common scenarios which are presented to every operating surgeon, the small bowel obstruction and the large bowel obstruction. Thank you, panelists. And I thank all the postgraduates who have taken part in this discussion. Thank you.